We're going to spend a little bit of time talking about a couple of different aspects of kidney stones. We're going to look at just some background information, and then also look at treatment options, and then also a little bit on prevention, which I think is a lot of what people may have questions about. Kidney stones kind of mirror the rust belt, if you will. There's a kidney stone belt that is to the south, and it has to do obviously with dehydration and increased temperatures. And this is actually a slide that shows that if you believe in climate change, and I certainly don't want to get into any political talks this evening or maybe ever, but if you believe in climate change and warming of the planet, you can see that the stone belt will kind of migrate to the north over the next several decades and in the rest of the century and show potential further increase in kidney stone events. How do we diagnose kidney stones? Well, let's back up a little bit. So the annual incidence of stones is greater than a million people. It represents about 1 in 300 chance of getting a stone. Your lifetime risk is right around 10%, but that seems to be on the rise. We used to see a ratio of 2 to 1 with female to male, but that's kind of going away now. It's more equal. We never really understood why that might be. And in case you're wondering, I mean, kids and even infants are at risk, but they have a much lower risk, thankfully. This seems to be more so a disease of adulthood than children. So how do we diagnose kidney stones? Well, it's going to be a lot on suspicion, any kind of pain in the back or side. This can be associated with nausea, with or without vomiting. You may see blood in the urine, have urinary symptoms. You may have an infection, with or without fever. But, when you're talking about a stone that's trying to pass, a ureteral stone, then that's really going to be evidenced with a lot of pain. Now, with larger stones, which is actually the area that I tend to specialize in more so, you don't necessarily have that same kind of a pain as if though you're getting struck in the back, with a rhinoceros. It's more of an achy pain or a discomfort. With these stones, sometimes they go undiagnosed. They can be found incidentally, which means that, we're not really looking for them, and you happen to get an x-ray and an ultrasound and a big stone is found. The concern with these larger stones is they don't necessarily cause that severe pain, so they don't have the same sort of red flags, if you will, but you can see greater risk of infections that can spread into the kidney, which is called pyelonephritis, or into the bloodstream. You have greater risk of injury to the kidney. So there's kind of two different kinds of stones. There's the smaller stones that can get into the ureter and cause pain and send patients to the ER. Then there's these larger stones, which are much rarer, that can be much more worrisome and damaging to a person's health without necessarily the same typical warning sign. So when we're looking at somebody who's presenting with pain that we believe is a kidney stone, there's obviously a couple other diagnoses that we need to consider and rule out. So not everything that causes pain in your back or side is going to be a kidney stone. We can use blood work. Look at your urine, what the urine looks like. Look at some blood tests and see if there's certain findings that we associate with kidney stones. But the reality is that in the year 2020, if we suspect a kidney stone, imaging is what's going to get us the answer. So what is imaging? Imaging is just a general term that we use that encompasses any and all kinds of X-ray tests, quote unquote, that we would do for a kidney stone. We have basically three tests that we use today more commonly. One's called the KUB, and that's really the only one on the list that's an actual X-ray, and it stands for kidney, ureters, and bladder. We do a lot of ultrasounds or sonograms, which we use sound waves to look inside the body. But the best test we have is a CT scan. Many people call it a CAT scan. CT scans, there's some concern about radiation exposure, but the reality is with these low-dose and ultra-low-dose scans, which are very good at detecting kidney stones, you have very little radiation. They're relatively low cost. They're quick tests, and they really give you the absolute best information to determine if you have a stone or how large it is and other factors. So looking at the anatomy as an overview, your kidneys sit kind of a third of the way up your back. The ureter, which is a very small structure about the size of a mouse cord, connects the kidney to the bladder. So the urine flows from the drainage system here inside the kidney down the ureter and into the bladder. On the plain x-ray, that KUB I mentioned earlier, you're going to see this. This is going to be what a stone would look like. This is an older test called an intravenous pyelogram, where we've actually injected some dye into the kidneys and through the bloodstream, and you can see the drainage system sort of lighting up, and it looks very similar to this diagram here. On this side here, you can see this is actually a stone that's blocking the kidneys. So the kidney's kind of swollen like a balloon. So that brings me to ultrasound. Ultrasound images tend to look, very hazy. Even when we're teaching medical students or early on in the residence training, it's kind of hard to see what you're really looking at. But the more and more you look at these pictures, they actually give you quite a bit of detail. So this here shows the kidney kind of in the outline, looks like a C. And then there's this central area that looks a little bit brighter. And then you've got this really bright spot with a black area that's kind of coming down. So that is a stone likely with a shadow. We can also look for things like something called hydronephrosis. So this is a good example of a stone here with a big white arrow on it. And there's a, you know, black shadow beneath it. If you look over to the right, you can see that there's kind of a more fullness. You lose that bright white center of the kidney. So that means that the kidney may be blocked there. So that's called hydronephrosis. But again, CT scans really are best test. So when we look at the scan, you can see very clearly, you know, there's a stone in that kidney on in the left kidney. The person's looking out at us. We can look at scans in a bunch, in a several different views, and give us a lot of detail. So here you've got somebody, the long arrows show stones, and then you've got the shorter arrows that show where the ureter goes. So you can see there's two stones blocking both kidneys. This would not be a good scenario. This is very bad luck. It means that, you know, each kidney has a stone that's causing a blockage. So that's definitely an emergency scenario. And then these are scans that show some very, very advanced kidney stones. So where you see all the big red arrow, that's a stone that's literally filling virtually the entire drainage system of that left kidney. On the other side, you see just very distorted kidney. The drainage system has been distorted by these large stones that are kind of overtaking the kidney. So these are obviously much more advanced cases here. You know, how do we treat kidney stones? So there's three different options in the modern world. Basically, there's shockwave lithotripsy, which many patients and even doctors refer to as simply lithotripsy. Lithotripsy refers to breaking stone. So really all procedures that we do for kidney stones are lithotripsy. But typically, as I said, people do call the shockwave treatment lithotripsy, dropping the other two words. Ureteroscopy with laser lithotripsy is another option. That's an internal scope. And then percutaneous nephrolithotomy refers to making a small incision through the back, typically into the kidney drainage system, to remove stones. So we like to use long words like shockwave lithotripsy, ureteroscopy, percutaneous nephrolithotomy, and then we like to use acronyms to make it easy. So SWL, URS, and PNL. Now, to be complete, you can do laparoscopic surgery with multiple small incisions and opening the kidney. You can do open surgery with a large incision and opening the kidney, but these are really not procedures that are done commonly today or really at all. So this is really what you're looking at for options. So how do we decide which treatment to offer a patient or which treatment might be best for a specific scenario? Well, size matters. You know, the larger the stone burden, there may be limitations to some of the less invasive procedures. Thankfully, most stones are quite small and most stones will pass on their own. But once you start to get into that medium-sized stones between 6 and 15 millimeters, we can use the ureteroscopy or the shockwave treatment. But once you get above 15 or certainly 20 millimeters, you're really looking at most likely a percutaneous approach to realistically treat the stone. So the other factor we look at is how hard matters. So at this point, you know, you've got me a urologist talking about size and talking about hardness. So you might think you tuned into the wrong webinar, but this is still about kidney stones. But we look at hardness with something called Hounsfield units. And so I admit this slide is going to be a bit wordy and scientific, but the bottom line is that I just want to make you familiar with this concept of the fact that we use two standards, air and water, and we define the density of air at minus 1,000 and water zero. We use that because we are primarily creatures made of water that live in an air environment. And so from that, we can develop this table here, which shows us that different tissues in our body, such as blood or muscle, are somewhere between 30 to 40, 45 Hounsfield units. And then when you get to bone, you're at around 300 to sometimes 600 Hounsfield units. But interestingly, when you look at stones and the hardness of stones, even the softer stones are really as hard as bone. And then you've got stones that can be many times harder. And this comes into play because if a stone is too hard, then again, some of the options that we listed as treatment options may not be effective at treating a stone that's extremely hard. And of course, location matters, where. So depending on where the stone is, we're going to, you know, opt for different treatment options. So again, looking at the anatomy, similar to the diagram I showed earlier, you can have stones that are inside the drainage system of the kidney. Those, the calceal stone, those tend to not be very painful because they're just sort of hanging out in the kidney. Once they move into the renal pelvis or into the ureter, that's when you typically have more pain. And then there's this other scenario called the diverticulum, where you've got a stone that's trapped in a pocket. So that looks like this on the CAT scan. You can see there's a little bright white stone kind of, and there's an area of light gray or, you know, around the stone, and same thing over here. So this is actually a pocket that's trapped the stone. And this again is a scenario where if you used shockwave, for example, or even your ureteroscopy, it may be difficult to get into the pocket or impossible to really get the stones to clear from the pocket. So this may be an indication to do a percutaneous approach. So again, overview of the treatments are shockwave lithotripsy, ureteroscopy, and percutaneous nephrolithotomy. Your urologist is going to look at your specific clinical scenario with the, you know, where the stones are, the hardness of the stones, the amount of stone, and determine which is the best option for treatment. Again, shockwave has limitations because you're passing the sound waves through the body to break the stone. So we look for softer stones, smaller size, and stones that are really in more favorable locations. This is a diagram of an older shockwave setup, and some patients may recall being literally hoisted into a tub. This is how we used to do the treatments many, many years ago, long before I got into medicine. This is what a modern machine looks like. So that same bathtub that was, a literal bathtub is now just a small cup of water that is on the table, and that allows a coupling to occur for the shockwave treatment to be effective. Here's just a little comedic relief. We got to be careful with technology because, you set the button a little wrong, then you may have not the best results. So rule of nines, this is again a little technical, but basically it's indicating that shockwave treatment is best for patients that are a little, not a little on the thinner side, softer stones, and not, too much stone burden in locations that we can more effectively treat. So if shockwave is determined not to be a good option, then we move on to something called ureteroscopy. Again, that word comes from the fact that we scope the ureter in order to, to treat stones in the ureter or in the kidney. This is kind of what the scopes look like. They're very small, miniaturized, and this is what a view might look like from a scope at a stone that's sitting in the ureter. So in theory, you can treat any size stone in any location, any density, et cetera. We have very good lasers now. We have high power lasers, and we can use something, we can do a treatments called stone dusting or fragmentation. So we can either use what's called a semi-rigid scope that is kind of a bendable metal scope that can go into the ureter, or we can use a truly flexible scope that's very much like a snake that can kind of, traverse through all the different parts of the kidney and get the stones in even difficult locations. The ureteroscopes are very small and delicate. Until recently, they were difficult to get good images, but with digital scopes, we've, really advanced our ability to see inside the body. So here's a video about what dusting might look like. So here what we're attempting to do is basically layer the stone and create enough fragments that are so tiny, almost like sand, that the stone will then just be able to clear out in the urine. In some, this is a video obviously of a stone that's dusting very nicely. Here's a video that shows fragmentation. So here that you're using higher power, and some stones just won't dust even if you want to try to dust them. So you kind of have to break them up, and you can see here now this stone is in a lot of pieces, and we will then, either break them into further smaller pieces or use a basket or a grasper to remove them. But remember, size matters. So even though in theory you can take care of almost any stone, any density, any location, when you're dealing with a very small structure like the ureter, a very small scope like the ureteroscope, it is a marvel of modern medicine. But at the same time, there are limitations really, because once you get to these bigger stones or these really hard stones, it can be very difficult to actually clear the stone out, because in essence, you're just breaking it up and allowing the body to pass quite a bit of stone on its own. So in those scenarios, we then switch gears to considering percutaneous surgery. This is an image of the first percutaneous surgery that was done around 40 years ago. It has evolved a lot since then, but the principles are very much the same. It's basically a small incision, typically through the back, into that drainage system to then be able to place scopes and other devices to get the stone out. So here's an image of that scan. This white area here in the kidney is just a huge stone. Again, shockwave lithotripsy in this case would not be indicated. You could try ureteroscopy, but I would tell you that with a stone of that size, it's going to take either multiple rounds of ureteroscopy, or you may never really get the stone out. And so this is a scenario where you'd want to consider making that small incision into the kidney so you can then more effectively treat that large stone. And then again, these are the scans I showed earlier with, just stones that have really overtaken the kidney on the one side there. And when the red arrow, you can see it's just growing all inside the kidney. And then this is yet another picture that shows what looks like the drainage system of a kidney that's actually all stone. And what you're seeing there are wires. So access is a step that is involved in getting from the outside world to the inside world. So we use different x-ray technology, ultrasound or fluoroscopy, which is like live x-ray. And we can use a scope, and then we can place wires into the different parts of the kidney and then allow us to create openings into that section of the kidney to then do surgery. So this is a showing that maneuver with a scope in the kidney. So you can see the x-ray images. Hopefully you can recognize that there's the arrow's on the needle. And this thing here is the scope. You can see kind of a collection of stone down here. And we basically line up the needle in two planes, and then we're able to just sort of pop the needle into the kidney in a very precise location. So this maneuver is really important to get down so you can do the percutaneous surgery, you know, kind of in just the right way or with the best angle into the kidney to get the stones out. Here, I'm going to show you a couple pictures. Again, here's an x-ray showing several stones in the bottom of this kidney. Again, the kidney has a lot of different, you know, twists and turns inside, has different projections. So you really want to fill it with contrast to kind of get the anatomy. And here, you know, getting a little technical here, but if you made the opening into the kidney in the wrong finger, so to speak, if you kind of think of all of those drainage areas as little fingers inside the kidney, then you might be, you know, in the wrong place to actually treat the stone. So we put a scope in and we kind of figure out exactly where we want to make an opening into the kidney so we can most efficiently and effectively clear these stones. We then use a similar technique as I showed earlier, where we put a needle in and then a wire. And then this is what the video looks like. So you can see with the scope, you know, there's quite a lot of stone that's in the way. So we kind of move the scope until we find an area of the kidney where we want to pop the needle in. Needle comes in. We're using x-ray guidance to kind of also help, you know, line this up. And we can kind of aim that needle towards the scope and place the wire. Once the wire goes in, the needle comes out. And then we use some dilators to get a second wire in because we want to have a backup. One wire will be alongside the actual sheath we put in, which is sort of like a straw that goes into the kidney. So here you're going to see two wires in just a moment. And once we have the two wires in, we have a couple different ways we can dilate, you know, or stretch the opening in. This is a balloon coming in. You're going to see that balloon kind of blow up. And so you can see that, you know, you go from a needle puncture to a little bit larger hole with two wires to then a balloon, and then that allows us to place a sheath and then do work on all these stones. So that's what the incision looks like. That's about as big as an incision as we'll ever make. We actually make incisions that are a half to a third of that size today with smaller percutaneous tracts and what's called mini PCNL or ultra mini PCNL. Here's a picture of the balloon going in, and this is what it looks like on x-ray. So you've got, you know, a sheath, got several wires, you know, got a scope in there, and then you're gonna go after the stones. And that's what it looks like on the external part of the body. So the important thing to note here is that we use wires as ways to guide our way in, and we have safety wires at all times. And we're doing this in a very precise and methodical way using x-rays, you know, the CT scan ahead of time, x-ray during the procedure, a scope in the kidney to really guide us in, to get into the kidney in a safe place where we can really effectively treat the stone. This is what it kind of looks like in our OR. So, you know, it's that white thing with a bag on it is, it's called a C-arm. That's how we get our x-ray images. You know, this is a scope with a lithotripter in there. That's the device we use to break up stone. So this is kind of what this looks like. So I'm going to skip ahead a little bit because this is the needle coming in and the wires and then some dilators. But here you're going to see this is what it might look like through the scope. And this is actually a mini procedure. So we're using an incision that's about 8 millimeters in size, 7 to 8 millimeters. So it's a very tiny incision, somewhere around a quarter to a third of an inch. And we're using a lithotripter and this is a pretty good sized stone. It's about an inch in size, the stone itself. And so we're using this device to break it up. And the device not only breaks it up like the laser can do in some of the pictures I showed you before, but it's actually suctioning or vacuuming the stone as we go. So you can kind of see some holes being developed in the stone. And then you can see that it's, you know, kind of breaking it up, and then it's literally like vacuuming the stone out. So this is something that we cannot achieve currently with ureteroscopy. We don't have anything that we can place without an incision into the kidney at this time that will actually suction and clear stone like you're seeing here. So this can only be done with a small incision. The shockwave treatment, by definition, is breaking the stone into pieces that your body will pass. So again, that involves you passing stone. So this percutaneous surgeries, particularly with the smaller incisions, where we go to the mini percutaneous or the ultra mini, you know, we're able to make just a tiny opening into the kidney, but that allows us to use instrumentation that's far more efficient at clearing stone than anything we have with ureteroscopy or with shockwave. And you might ask yourself, well, why is that? And it's really because of the size of the ureter. The ureter is a very tiny structure. You know, again, it's about, looks something like a piece of spaghetti or linguine. So it does stretch, allows a scope to go in there, but you know, you're not really able to put much in there. You also have to worry about flow so you can see what you're doing. You don't want to put too much flow in there because that can also put too much pressure on the kidney. So there's many limitations to ureteroscopy that we are working to see if we can maybe advance the technology. But at this time, and you know, maybe forever, you know, an incision is always going to allow you to do a little bit more than you can ever do through the natural ureter in the, that the body has, just because it's all, you know, just size limitation, flow limitation. So here we're just kind of suctioning out, you know, any blood clots and things, because sometimes you can have little fragments of stone stuck in there. So our goal is to render this patient completely stone free. There's no pieces of stone to pass. You know, we can tell them with pretty good certainty that there's, that they're completely stone free for the day of surgery. On x-ray, you can see that this is showing you that the stones are gone. The sheath is still in there. This is a small incision. So what do we do with the incision? Once we're done with the surgery, we put a plug in. So it's exactly like what it sounds like. It's literally just something that kind of fills that space that we created. This allows us to have a little bit of a safety blanket in that, you know, we're putting something in to help the body heal that space. Because of the way the surgery is done, there's no way to actually suture or close the opening that we made. So the best we can do is put a sealant or a plug in. We then use absorbable stitches and skin glue, and you know, basically leave with a band-aid on your back and just a little small incision and a very tiny scar in the end. Especially with, as I keep mentioning, with these smaller incisions that we do with the mini surgeries and ultra mini surgeries. So I think a majority of the questions that I've seen ahead of time, and I think an area of great interest for many, many patients, is stone prevention. What I tell all the patients that I take care of is, I'm a surgeon at heart and I love doing stone surgeries. And usually I'm meeting people when they have either very large stones or complex stones, or you know, they're in the middle of trying to pass a larger ureteral stone and they're not, life is not so good. And so my goal is to get you past that stone event, get rid of all the stones in your body, make you stone free. But then I want to keep you stone free. And keeping somebody stone free means that you've got to do, you know, your part as well. I think that this is an area that, you know, is not really well. Many physicians don't go into prevention. Certainly primary care physicians, ER doctors, they're not really well versed in this. Even general urologists may not, you know, really have a good understanding on how to really fully evaluate somebody and do testing to customize a stone prevention plan. But that's something that I offer every patient. And, you know, here at Chesapeake Urology, and you can go to our chesapeakeurology.com/telehealth website. Again, that's chesapeakeurology.com/telehealth. And you know, if you're interested in scheduling one of these visits, we're happy to help you set that up. So what's involved in stone prevention? Well, the fancy name for stone prevention is called metabolic testing or metabolic workup. What that refers to is that there's some underlying disorder that likely is causing certain people to form stones, because really, you know, otherwise we would all form them. What's really helpful to a urologist who's taking care of you is to get the stone analyzed. Now, many patients think once you get the stone analyzed, doc, tell me what I need to do to prevent future stones. Most stones are going to be calcium-based. And as we go through a couple of these slides, you're going to see that calcium-based stones are common and there's many reasons you can make them. So unless you have a rarer stone, like a uric acid stone or a stone that's a precipitate of a certain drug or other rare stones, really the stone analysis only confirms that you likely have a calcium stone that most people have. Then you need to do other steps. The other steps involve often some blood work to look for what we call systemic causes of kidney stones. But the most important test is a 24-hour or a 48-hour at-home urinary collection. So this is done by you at home. The testing is a kit that arrives in the mail. Everything you need is in the kit to do the testing. And then you send that back to the lab. It's very important that you do an actual 24-hour collection and that you give the lab a sample of that, because then we're going to be able to look at the chemistry of your kidney and understand, you know, the specifics as to how or why it is that maybe you're making stones. As I mentioned, most stones are calcium-based. Calcium oxalate's the most common. Calcium phosphate's another type. Uric acid stones, again, a little bit about this. Many people associate uric acid stones with gout. The reason is that gout, you know, which for those of you that don't know what gout is are uric acid crystals that deposit in the great toe or in the knee. They cause a lot of pain. it is the same crystal as a uric acid stone, but really the treatment is very different. So if you have gout, it doesn't mean you're going to have uric acid stones. If you have uric acid stones, it doesn't mean you're going to have gout. And then the way we approach and treat each one is quite different. And as a urologist, I don't treat gout, but as a urologist, particularly who focuses on kidney stones, I treat a lot of patients with uric acid stones. And the treatment is very different. And once you get the right treatment for uric acid stones, it's quite possible that you'll never make a uric acid stone again. Struvite stone is another stone that we encounter not uncommonly. This is associated with infections. Again, even if you have infection-related stones, many times you still have an underlying metabolic disorder. And again, the most common stone type is going to be a mix. Some calcium oxalate, some calcium phosphate. Struvite stone, sometimes even uric acid stone. So the stone analysis, as I said, usually just, you know, points us in the right direction or confirms that we have infection or calcium stone. It doesn't usually tell us really everything we need to know about how to prevent it. And there's also drug-related stones and other stones, which I'll get into in a little bit. But again, the story here is that your stone analysis is important, but it's probably not as important as you might think, because most of you who have stones are going to have the calcium-based stones. So there are some less common disorders that can cause kidney stones. And this is what some of the blood work helps to identify. Hyperparathyroidism, basically this means your parathyroid gland is overactive. It causes an imbalance in the calcium metabolism in your body and causes your body to actually leach calcium from the bones. And this ends up in the urine and increases the urinary calcium and increases stone formation. The solution to hyperparathyroidism is to figure out that you have it and then figure out which of your parathyroid glands is overactive and then see a neck surgeon who can take care of that for you. For those of you that are wondering, you know, what is a hyperparathyroid? Is it my thyroid? So your thyroid gland is, again, an important gland. It sits on your neck. It's like an H in the shape of an H. Your parathyroids are literally named for the fact that they live next to the thyroid gland. So they're actually separate glands. And in this case, the word para just means next to. So there's usually four or sometimes five small pea-sized glands that kind of live around the thyroid. And that's the reason we call it a parathyroid. So it really has not much to do with your thyroid, except that it's your thyroid's neighbor. Renal tubular acidosis is another disorder that can lead to kidney stones. Again, we usually suspect this because there's certain clinical factors that we see, and we tend to see calcium phosphate stones in this scenario. So this is something, again, that we can pick up both with the stone analysis as well as the some blood work, and then the 24-hour urine, as well as clinical suspicion. Now, cystinuria is a rare disorder. We believe there's only about 10,000 people in the United States who have cystinuria. Cystinuria refers to the fact that you're born with an inherent inability to basically break down four amino acids, cysteine, ornithine, lysine, and arginine. And so these kind of pass in high concentration into the urine and form stones. So there are cysteine stones, and these patients will make, you know, continue to make stones, and they can make very large ones. And so every couple of years they're dealing with, you know, big stones and having to have surgery, but there is treatment for that. The number one thing is to identify it. This is one case where the stone analysis will give you a huge amount of information, but even so, the 24-hour urine was going to really give you the details you need to manage the disorder and then to take medication to help, you know, minimize the risk of recurrent cysteine stones. Now, I said that there's four different amino acids that your body can't break down, but the other ones, the ornithine, the lysine, and the arginine, we don't see those stones because they actually don't form crystals within the body at the pHs that our body exists. So we're lucky in that sense, but one of those four does form stones. And again, for the unfortunate people who have that, it is a big problem. So this is more a list of things that, you know, applies to most people. So these are the things that most patients are saying to me, tell me what I need to do to not make any more kidney stones. Well, there are dietary factors, and then there are what I call inherent factors. So dietary factors are things that you do have control over, obviously. The most obvious one is dehydration. If you can, you know, get good at drinking a lot more water than maybe you're used to, or a lot more water than most people, because when you're a kidney stone former, you don't want to just be well hydrated, you want to be super hydrated. In terms of other general recommendations, you know, in general, excess salt, too much animal protein, I think those are two that I see with some regularity in the 24-hour urines that we check. Those can lead to environments in your kidney that promote kidney stones. Oxalates are actually things that, foods that are very healthy for you, things like spinach and other green leafy vegetables. peanuts, peanut butter, and other nuts. I am not a believer that high oxalates in your diet, you know, generally lead to stones. I think that they can contribute to stones, particularly if you have very, very high levels. I think in most cases, at least from a diet standpoint, the elevated oxalates is probably something that most people can not focus on. And then calcium. It is true that most stones are calcium based, so you don't want to overdo calcium. But there is, you know, a misconception out there that if you have a calcium stone, which again is going to be most people, that you should avoid calcium or dairy products, and that's not true. You want to have the right amount of calcium, both for, you know, keeping your body, you know, your body needs calcium for you know, its day-to-day functions. But if you actually cut calcium out too much, you can increase your risk of calcium stones, because most stones are calcium oxalate. Your body absorbs calcium and oxalate in tandem. If you get too low on your calcium levels, then your body will hyperabsorb the oxalates, and then you'll end up potentially with more kidney stones than you had before. Now, I did say that oxalates is something I don't really worry about too much, but there are some disorders where you have inflammatory bowel issues or prior bowel surgery, weight loss-related bowel surgery, such as gastric bypass. Then you end up with enteric hyperoxaluria, so that's just a fancy way of saying lots of oxalates in the urine, generally because of there's a, you know, absorption issue. So in that scenario, the oxalates can be a problem, and a low oxalate diet would be recommended. Now, what are inherent factors? Inherent factors will include things like the acidity of the urine. You know, very acidic urine can lead to uric acid stones as well as calcium-based stones. A very low urinary citrate. Citrate is found in highest concentrations in lemons, lemonade, lemon juice. But I will tell you that most people who have very low citrate levels, it's not because of their diet. It's just inherent in them. And then even if they increase the dietary citrate, you're probably not going to get a big enough response without actually taking medication or using supplements. Your kidney itself can mismanage calcium. So that's called renal leak hypercalciuria. That means the kidney doesn't really manage the calcium properly. You end up with excess calcium in the urine. Again, diet can exacerbate this, but even if you had a quote-unquote perfect diet with, you know, no excess calcium, excellent hydration, etc., you may still end up with stones because your kidney is kind of malfunctioning, and that requires medication. And again, you're not going to find out about renal leak hypercalciuria unless you go through all the tests I mentioned, the stone analysis, the blood work, and then primarily the 24-hour urine. And in some cases, a basic urinary pH can lead to calcium phosphate stones. Again, renal tubular acidosis, I mentioned earlier, we can sometimes see those kind of stones. So the pH is something that we have to balance. So for certain stone types, if you give medication that makes the pH more basic, you can actually induce more stones. So again, there's a balance point with everything, and you really need to go through the testing and have somebody that really understands how to evaluate those tests to really give you good advice. So what's my take-home message? Get tested, because if you don't go through the tests, if you don't get your stone analyzed, and in particular, if you don't do the 24-hour urine and blood work as necessary, and again, the 24-hour urine tests are things that we're going to want to repeat. So you're going to get it once as a baseline, but then once we, you know, either make diet changes, give you supplements or medications, we want to recheck it to see if we're getting the result that we're looking for, and then make further adjustments as necessary. I would also advise everybody who has kidney stones or who's had recurrent stones to see a urologist like myself, or one of my colleagues, at least once a year to get a checkup. And on that year visit, I usually do recommend the 24-hour urine before your visit so we have something to look at, as well as possibly an ultrasound to do a screen of your kidneys and just to kind of see how things are. So if you're interested in setting up a visit, again, we'll get to the question and answers here in a minute. Just remember that it's ChesapeakeUrology.com/telehealth. So that's a way for you to get on your devices and talk to a urologist in our practice. That's ChesapeakeUrology.com/telehealth. Again, there are a lot of questions being submitted, which is great. You know, I'm glad that you're out there listening and that you have questions. But if I don't get to your question, or if I don't fully answer your question, again, remember, I think the best thing you can do is schedule a visit. Again, we keep promoting this, but it's ChesapeakeUrology.com/telehealth. Is a way for you to get, you know, a more one-on-one visit with myself or one of our doctors. One of the questions is, you said that consuming lemon juice would have limited ability to affect low citrate. How would you treat low citrate? And particularly, are there medications or supplements that you'd recommend? Don't get me wrong. Adding lemon juice and lemons to your diet is recommended for practically all kidney stone formers, but especially if you have low citrate. But when we look at the 24-hour urine, it depends on how, you know, how, where you are in terms of just how low you are. So to give you some numbers, you know, baseline, we'd like you to be greater than about 500 or 600. I've seen patients whose citrate levels are below 100. And I can tell you that no matter how much lemonade or lemon juice you use, you're not going to be ever be able to get up into the 400, 500, 600 range. So in those cases, where the low citrate is very low, we'd want to use medications or supplements such as potassium citrate, which is available by prescription only, because again, to give you meaningful amounts of citrate, certain things monitored, particularly your blood potassium level, your 24-hour urine citrate levels. So that's only available by prescription. There are some over-the-counter potassium citrates, but they're very, very small amounts. Again, they probably won't treat most patients effectively if they have very low citrate. Now, if you have borderline low citrate, if your citrate level is 400, 450, so you're only about 100 points or so below target, then you may be able to do it just with diet. Another question, what are your thoughts on daily vitamins, men's one a day, as contributing to forming more stones? So in general, the one a day vitamins, the main thing I look at is the amount of calcium that's in the vitamins. So most of the one a days that I've looked at, and you have to really kind of look at the specific one that you're taking, will have somewhere between 300 to 600 milligrams of calcium in it. That's really not a whole lot extra, presuming that you don't have a lot of calcium in your diet already. Where I get concerned is if someone's taking a multitude of vitamins and they're not really aware of how much calcium is in the vitamins, and they end up, you know, between their diet and their vitamins, they're at, you know, 1500 to 2000 milligrams of calcium. So now they're kind of overloading their body with calcium. What your body does when there's extra calcium, it goes into the urine. So that can be a stone risk. Another question, is a stent required in the surgeries you described? So I did talk about three different procedures, the shockwave treatment, the ureteroscopy, and the percutaneous surgery. I would not say that a stent is required for any of them, but I would say that a stent may be recommended depending on the amount of work that needs to be done. I would say that for most percutaneous surgeries, we do place a stent. The other option is to put a nephrostomy tube. I didn't talk about that very much, but you could put a tube into the kidney through the back. Most patients who've had that would rather have a stent than a tube in their back. Also, when you have a tube in your back, it tends to cause more pain, and many of those surgeries end up being done in a hospital as opposed to in an outpatient setting. In terms of stenting for ureteroscopy or for shockwave, it really depends on the amount of stone that you're treating and how the procedure went. So a lot of ureteroscopies end up with a stent because you are putting a scope into the ureter. And even if the procedure is very straightforward and the stone comes out pretty easily, or you're able to dust the stone, there's always concern that there could be swelling or a clot that could block the tube, and then you'd end up with a problem and you'd have to put a stent later on. So stents aren't required, but I kind of look at stents as unfortunately for many people, they're very uncomfortable, but they're kind of a necessary nuisance because it's an insurance policy against something more significant occurring. Another question, I am 64 years old. Do stones decrease as you get older? Thank you. So there doesn't really seem to be an age predilection for stones. In other words, 25-year-olds and 65-year-olds all have about the same risk. The one thing I would say is that the older you are, you actually may have an increased risk of having a stone event, only because statistically, you know, particularly if your body's chemistry is such that you may be at risk for forming stone, the longer you're around and the greater the probability is that underlying metabolic disorder that we kind of briefly touched on at the end of the presentation, that could lead to a stone. But in general, no, you're not really safe the older you are. You're not really safe, you know, if you're young. Only if you're very, very young, under the age of 15, do we really see a much lower incidence. Another question, have you noticed any links between stones and well water? So there's been some studies done on this, and I'm a little hesitant to answer this completely truthfully, because the bottom line is that most studies have shown that as long as you drink a lot of anything, it's better than not drinking. And that would not just mean well water, you know, or such a thing as hard or soft water or bottled water. It would basically mean anything, including sodas, coffee, tea. I try to encourage my patients not to drink certain things like sodas, just because I think there's other health issues with that. I personally think that if you drink a lot of fluids that dehydrate you, that you know, if you don't catch up with water, that you can end up, even though you're drinking a lot, you may end up being dehydrated or intermittently dehydrated. But to answer your question, no, we don't really, the studies that have been done have really shown that it doesn't really matter where you get your water. It's more a matter of, do you drink enough of it? So if you can drink a lot of well water, you're probably better off than drinking less of any other kind of water. Another question, how long does it take to form a uric acid stone? The bigger question is, how long does it take for stones to form in general? And the answer is, it depends. It's variable. So we don't have a defined timeline for kidney stones to form. In other words, I can't tell you that if you have a 1 millimeter stone today, you know, in 2 years, it's going to be a 4 millimeter stone. It could be a 4 millimeter stone in a month, or it could still be a 1 millimeter stone 2 years from now. So there is no defined timeline by which stones grow. I will say that if you are someone who's experienced stones, had your stones removed or past stones, you know, you kind of prove that with a CT scan that didn't show any more stone that was remaining, and then a month or two or three later, you have a new stone, then, you know, you may be someone who's a rapid stone former. In particular, uric acid stones will form, as I mentioned, in acidic urine. So if you can take medication to alkalinize the urine, to take the acidity out, then that's a scenario where you really should stop making them. As long as that's really the only thing that you have going on, that's the only metabolic disorder you have, then alkalinization of your urine to a pH above 6 will, in essence, rid you of uric acid stone recurrence. And I've seen that in dozens of patients who were forming stones, you know, once a year on the average for years before they came to see me. They were all uric acid stones. And then, you know, through some medications that buffer the urine, they were able to get the urine pH up. And now I've been seeing them for many years and they don't have any stones, and they haven't had any stones since. So uric acid stones are one where I really think if you can get that diagnosed and properly treated, you can literally get a cure, which is not possible for most other stone scenarios, to be clear. So if you make calcium-based stones, most of the time we can't cure you of them. We can just decrease your risk. What medication is recommended for renal leak hypercalciuria? That's a very specific disorder. Again, you want to make sure that that's, you know, diagnosed with extensive testing and confirmed. Once that's confirmed, we would use what's called a thiazide diuretic to have the kidneys hold on to the calcium that they're losing. The trade-off is that you lose more potassium, so then we generally have to give you a potassium replacement. Many times we use potassium citrate because that not only replaces the potassium that you've lost, but it gives you extra citrate. And as I mentioned in this talk, citrate does help prevent kidney stones. So, you know, why not get extra citrate if you can at the same time you're getting the potassium? What are the best preventatives for uric acid stones? I think we've covered this. Primarily, knowing that you have them, alkalinizing the urine. You can consider a low purine diet. So purines are precursors to uric acid. You can either look that up on Google, or we can give you the information in the office. But again, for the most part, it's getting that pH above 6. And for most uric acid stone formers, that's going to take care of it. I did mention there's an association between gout and uric acid stones. Again, it's more of an association, but we can use some of the gout treatments for uric acid stones. So things like allopurinol can also be used. But for prevention, I would say a low purine diet, lots of water, and then mostly figure out how to get the acid out of the urine by taking medication. Another question, it's a good one. If one has kidney stones, should they avoid antacids such as Tums when they have acid reflux? So Tums is one of the over-the-counter medications that is loaded with calcium. When you look at the amount of calcium that you're consuming in a day, you want to shoot for about 1,000 milligrams a day. And the range is between 800 and 1,200 milligrams a day. Tums will have 600 milligrams of calcium in one Tums, and most patients that take Tums will take maybe one or two or three. So you can see that on that day, you're going to overload your body with calcium. So if you take Tums on a regular basis and you take multiple doses of Tums on a regular basis, then I would agree that that is something you want to avoid as a kidney stone former. You know, if you take an occasional Tums, it's probably okay, but I would not make it a routine part. And perhaps you can get your reflux treated in other ways besides an over-the-counter medication like Tums. Here's a very specific question. I'll read it. I had a 10 millimeter stone that enlarged my kidney. It was taken out via ureteroscopy, and later on I passed the small stones. My question is, how often should I have a CT scan to check that there are no other stones in my kidneys? maybe have a metabolic test like you explained. What the question here is, once you've had a kidney stone event, and I define that as either being surgery or a treatment to remove the stone, or you pass the stone on your own, then, you know, what's the recommendation thereafter? So if you've had a procedure, 100% you should get at least an ultrasound, you know, within 2 months of your of having the procedure be done. So whether you if you had a stent, within 2 months of having the stent out, if you had a shockwave within a couple months of that treatment, you should have an ultrasound to make sure that your kidney, there's nothing going on inside that maybe you're not perceiving. Beyond that, if we're looking to for recurrence or we're concerned about recurrence, as this person is, I would say that you want to have some kind of an imaging test. And again, ultrasound's a great one that we have available in our offices. Ultrasound is one that, you know, zero radiation, and it's a good screening test. I don't think it's as good as a CT scan to really identify the number of stones or the size of stones if they're there, but it's a good screening test. I would get that every, you know, within 6 to 12 months of again, having a procedure or a stone event, and then I would consider once a year having that. Now, should you get a CT scan again just to check at some point? I mean, maybe. I will say that ultrasound doesn't always catch every stone. More often I see ultrasound overestimate or, you know, makes us think there's stone in there and then the CAT scan shows it's not there. I would say I don't recommend routinely getting a CT scan, but if it's been 2 or 3 years and previously you had a lot of recurrent stones, it wouldn't be, you know, a bad idea to do one of the low dose CT scans to make sure that the ultrasound is really giving us the full picture. And then, yes, your second statement there, I do recommend metabolic testing. I didn't cover this, but it's recommended for anybody who's had more than one stone and also for anybody who's younger. So I think the reason if you're, you know, say under the age of even, you know, 45 or 50, you know, you're hopefully going to be around for many decades to come. And so the metabolic testing can give you that information to help prevent a recurrence. And then if you've had a recurrence, I think a metabolic test is a must. In my practice, I offer it to anybody and everybody. So if you're a first-time stone former, I will still offer it to you. And I think it's you know, it doesn't hurt to get one of those tests, at least to get a good look. Then if you're very young, you know, certainly if you're under age 20, under age 15, I think metabolic testing is a must because now you've got decades and decades. And plus those stones can really cause an injury to the kidneys that can even result in kidney failure if you're very young and you're having a lot of stones. So this one said, I had a ureteroscopy to remove an 8 millimeter stone. A stent was not used after the procedure. Is there a reason for that? I am grateful. Again, that using a stent is going to be at the discretion of the urologist who's treating you. I don't know all the details of your surgery, but I would say that very likely a straightforward surgery. The urologist didn't feel that the stent was necessary. What the studies show is that if you routinely don't stent patients after your ureteroscopy, you're going to have about 1 in 10 come back and need a stent. And, you know, that's not a huge number, but if that's you, if you're the 1 in 10, then that can be quite an ordeal to get a stent placed after the fact. There's another question I think is sort of related. It says, I had a ureteroscopy and experienced a lot of bleeding. Is this fairly common with this procedure? One thing I tell patients is that it doesn't take a lot of blood in the urine to make it look, you know, like it's a lot. I warn patients that it's unsettling and it's frightening to see blood when you urinate, but anytime you have a kidney stone, even if you haven't had a procedure, if you've had a shockwave treatment or a ureteroscopy or a stent, it just stirs up bleeding. And so you see a lot of red urine, you know, unless it's really clotting or blocking the flow of urine, it tends to look a lot worse than it is. I've had some patients who get very nervous about the amount of blood they're seeing in the urine. So we check a blood count on them primarily to just reassure them. And I can tell you that unless you're clotting or you're really blocking up the flow of urine with clots, the likelihood that you're bleeding of any significance is virtually zero. And the times I have checked blood counts on those patients who really felt like there was more bleeding than they were comfortable with, the blood counts were stable. So, you know, you're really not losing as much blood as you think you might be. I really do appreciate all the questions. We do have ChesapeakeUrology.com/telehealth, where if you want to get some one-on-one time with myself or another urologist in our practice, very likely answer some of those questions you might have. So thank you everybody for tuning in and for all the participation. greatly appreciate it.